With less than 2 weeks to Election Day, it's time to talk about the news media. In addition to their regular job of reporting what happened, they now have the extra full-time job of sorting out truth from a nonstop torrent of lies. It's a hugely important task, and I'm not sure they're equipped for it. Don't get me wrong now. Investigative reporters have done outstanding work during the Trump era. A-plus guys. I hope you survive the next round of layoffs. But the outlets serving us breaking news and politics 24/7 don't seem to be making us smarter. And there's never been a worse time for us to be dumb. So here to talk more about that is award-winning documentarian, journalist, and CEO of Soledad O'Brien Productions, Soledad O'Brien. Welcome, Soledad. So great having you here.
Nice to see you. Thank you.
Great seeing you too. Now, we're so excited to have you here because you're not only a great journalist, but you have done some amazing real-time critiquing of news and media on Twitter. No, it's fascinating. I love watching it. And one of the things you talked about was, you called it the dangers of both sides-ism. First of all, what is that? And secondly, why is it so bad? And if you could give me both sides, I'd really appreciate that.
Well, on one hand, both sides-ism is to make sure as you're doing a story, you say essentially that. Well, on this hand, this person does this, but you know, this person does that. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's actually a valid thing to do. Okay. But often you're comparing two people who are very different. One thing we've seen in this election cycle is Joe Biden makes a gaffe. He's in Kenosha, Wisconsin, and he talks about, hey, if I don't wrap up, these people are going to shoot me in a place where there was a terrible shooting. So awkward. Shouldn't have done it. Messy.
Yeah.
But it's sort of the both sides of, well, Donald Trump said that he thinks journalists are enemies of the people, and also he's going to try to kill your voting rights, and also he's lying about whether or not he's ever sent in a ballot by mail, right? So clearly those two things are not equal. So having a sense of proportion is much more important than saying, well, I've got one thing about him and one thing about him, and that's both sides-ism. So it doesn't really educate people who are listening. And my rule of thumb, which I think is a pretty good one, is like, don't put BS on TV. Yeah. Do not elevate things that are clearly lies or untrue, and be very careful that when you're comparing people that you're being proportionate in your response.
Where did this come from? Because you mentioned CNN. Do you think they were conflating election time, equal time with actual reporting the facts of something? Because it seems like there's a conflation of something there.
Yeah, it definitely happens a lot during a political cycle. But I don't think it has anything to do with the rules around everybody gets equal time, all the candidates get equal time. I think it's much more of a sense of, don't look at me, I'm just telling you, he says the moon is made of cheese. Yes. She seemed to want to, you know, do such and such with NASA. I don't know, sounds equal to me. And it really is just kind of the lowest common denominator of trying to come across as being fair. Yeah. And I don't think necessarily the goal is about clarity, right? I think why put nine people on TV at once if the goal is clarity? Why is Rick Santorum talking about anything outside of like how to be a congressman? Really, he's an expert in being a congressman. If you want him to talk about that, fantastic. But he shouldn't be talking pretty much about anything else. And so I don't honestly believe that the goal is always, hey, we're really trying to educate people. I think it's to keep costs to a minimum, right? Those folks are relatively inexpensive over a year. They're all on contract. And I think it really is to keep a conversation going. And I also think conflict is a very good motivator. It feels like you're having an interesting show if people are yelling at each other, if this person's mad at this person versus, so let me explain what gerrymandering is. Let me walk you through what your First Amendment rights are and are not, right? Those are very clear, less interesting TV, I think people believe.
Yeah, it's almost anti-informative in some ways, you know? Like when something is clearly racist, the New York Times has done this too. They dance around like trying to describe it, you know, using euphemisms for racism or that type of thing. And it's like, guys, we're adults. Just talk to us directly. Why do you think there's so much avoidance of that type of direct language?
We're in a weird place where being accused of being a racist is worse than actually doing or saying something that's racist, right? So you get
completely
these weird phrases like racially tinged.
Yes,
what was
that's
racially,
exactly.
Like, what the actual hell is racially tinged? Well, I don't even know what that is, right?
Right.
I think the New York Times is really bad when they write about race. Peter Baker the other day was talking about Donald Trump and all this really, I mean, clearly just an embrace of white supremacy. And he lays it all out, but he just can't say this is textbook racism. And by the way, we know from Donald Trump's history, there are lots of racist things that he's said and done publicly, right? And no one, I didn't have to dig through any secret, you know, vault, done publicly. And for some reason, journalists feel very uncomfortable with saying these things are racist. People who say these things are racists.
Mm. I feel like a lot of journalism hasn't been honest about their complicity with racism, you know? I think the LA Times very recently kind of apologized for its part in it.
Listen, when I worked in local news, we used to cover the perp walk.
Yes,
so the perp walk was the cops would take a person and walk them around. And if you're a reporter, you need about 9 seconds, right? You need to be able to say, Jonathan Samuel Smith was arrested. I need to cover all that for my first line. So they're actually, right, the police are doing you a solid when they do that because they give you 9 seconds of your opening video.
Wow.
They really got to shape the narrative all the time. And it took a while as a young reporter to realize, like, oh, we probably shouldn't do this. This is not good for us to be thinking this way. So is that complicit? I don't think I was even smart enough in a way when I was doing that to be complicit, but I was definitely elevating their point of view on a story, which might have been right, but also might have not been right.
Yeah, you almost have to do journalism on yourself, you know, investigative journalism on yourself, and just to check yourself. One of the things you talked about this summer, journalism kind of had a Me Too moment for Black journalists this summer or Black issues. I thought that was interesting. Can you elaborate on that? And what did you mean by that?
Well, you know, it's so funny when people will chase after corporations or businesses, right, and talk about their lack of diversity. There was actually a moment on CNN was doing that, talking about, you know, Fox's lack of diversity. I'm like,
Exactly.
So remind me again, how many Black executives were...
Excuse me, Caucasian News Network. Excuse me.
I love working at CNN, and I really appreciate cable news. I do. And I love journalism.
Yeah.
But at some point, right, there's a sense of, well, we're not going to hold ourselves accountable. We're actually only going to hold other people accountable. And I think that's a kind of hypocrisy that people really, really recognize.
I wanted to ask you also, how do you think the pandemic is being covered? Because I'm confused many times, and I'll tell you why. So much of it is being mixed in with politics. Like, for instance, CNN will have the body count, you know, and all that stuff in their corner. Fox will have the stock market rally in their corner. I was like, what are we supposed to be thinking about?
I think one problem is because the president has really been campaigning for 4 years, right? Normally, the way it works is you have White House correspondents, they cover the election, they cover the inauguration, they go away.
Yeah.
Instead, for the last 4 years, they've been framing all the conversation. So we're having a conversation about a pandemic, but it's being led by the political press corps. So you frame everything as a press story. Who wins in this? Who loses with this? This story, how's it gonna hit? How's it gonna fall? Versus, what does science tell us about wearing a mask? And by the way, we should not then elevate things that are untrue. If science tells us, and we believe this, what we're not gonna do is let people who are lying come on our air and use us as a platform. So I think it's been very confusing.
Has there been permanent damage done by Trump's attacks on the media? And by damage, I mean our ability to just trust the media in general, you know? And even for somebody like me who supports it, it sometimes, like, Trump is winning, I have to say, with some of this, you know, his ability to just lower our level of trust.
Yeah, I think damage has been done. I think that there's been a chipping away for quite a long time now of trust in institutions, and the news is one of those institutions. And so sometimes I feel like we in the media aid and abet our own undermining. Mm-hmm. So for example, when I watched the White House press corps and the White House, they had them all put close together, even though we were in the middle of, and still are, in the middle of a pandemic.
Yeah.
I was like, I wonder, is someone gonna stand up and say, no, we're not doing this?
Yes.
They chose not to. There are lots of times when I think they don't know how to handle this president. And so I guess it kind of looks like he's winning. It's weird, right?
Yeah.
So I do think sometimes the media, when they make jokes, when they retweet things that are clearly wrong or poorly reported, they don't do themselves a service. They really do themselves a disservice because it starts chipping away at your overall trust of the media. I love the media. I read everything. I subscribe to everything. I give so much money to the New York Times, even as I'm tweeting at the New York Times, like, it's racism, please. But I love the New York Times. Yeah. And I retweet a lot of their really good reporting. I do hope we can come out the other side of this and not have damaged how much people need and rely on news. And certainly local news is struggling right now across the country. And I really hope that we're able to save local news.
Yeah, me too. And I criticize a lot, but I support it and love it as well, you know. And I support and love Soledad O'Brien, you guys.